Hi.
Welcome to Take Your Child to Work Day. This is the NIAMS Health Zones, and we're talking about skin. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to the Skin Zone. My name is Susan, and this is Caroline, and we're going to talk about our skin. Did you know that the skin is an organ, like your lungs or your heart? It is. In fact, it's the largest organ because it covers the surface area of your body, and a normal adult has about 6 pounds of skin. Now, we're looking at the layers of the skin here, because up here we have the dermis. That's the part that people see. And then, yeah, the epidermis, and then the dermis. The epidermis is what people see. And then we have the dermis, and then we have the hypodermis underneath. And that's where we have our hair comes out and our sweat glands come out. And if we talk a little bit more about the epidermis, can everybody put your hand in here? Let's compare. There we go. Because our skin has different pigment in it, and that's based on the amount of melanin we have in our skin. So Caroline here, it looks like she has the most. Looks like you're running pretty close to second there. I might be the one with the least, but this is showing about how our melanin in our skin gives our skin its particular color. So when you go out into the sun and you might get a tan, that's your skin's way of saying, oh, I'm being attacked. I better produce some more melanin to darken up the skin to protect it. So if you do a lot of tanning, we don't recommend that you do a lot of tanning. Or if you get too much sun, do you know what happens to you? You get a sunburn, yes. That's even worse than a suntan, and that hurts. So we don't want you to get either of those, neither a tan nor a sunburn. During the summer, when the sun is strongest, it's usually strongest between the hours of 10 in the morning and 4 in the afternoon. So we recommend that you stay inside during those days. Maybe do some indoor activities, maybe do some activities in the shade. But you have to remember that the ultraviolet rays that are coming from the sun, they can still reach you even if you're in the shade, because they can reflect. They can bounce up off of things like concrete, sand, water, and even snow. It's possible to get too much sun even in the middle of winter when you're in the snow, because those rays are still reaching you. You don't want to get too much. So if you can't stay inside all day, and we don't recommend that you stay inside all day every day, but suppose you're going out swimming or going out on a picnic, maybe you're having a sporting event, you want to make sure your skin is covered by what?
Sunscreen,
that's right. So we have 3 samples here. Which one do you think would be the best, that would give you the most protection? Why?
Because it says 70.
It says 70, yeah. The higher number, the better it is. Now, just because you're wearing sunscreen, that's not a good reason to go out and bake your son in the sun all day. It's just you have to make sure that you put it on, so you do what you have to do. And then you have to remember that even the waterproof kind, it can wear off. It can wear off if you go in the water, like if you go swimming, or like if you sweat a lot, or even, you know, just by like rubbing a towel all over you to wipe off all that sweat. So you have to remember, you have to reapply it. You have to read the label so that you know when to reapply it. So an interesting thing that our skin has also is a little bitty nerve endings. So each one of you pick up one of these blocks here and go ahead and touch each side. Each side feels a little bit different. What sense are you using when you feel that? Of your 5 senses.
Do you know which sense you're using? Are you hearing it?
Are you tasting it? Yeah, you're touching it. It's your sense of touch. So that's why your skin has nerve endings in it, so that you can feel things, and that's how you interact with the world. Now, did you ever wonder what it might feel like to be skinless? If you didn't have your skin there and you were just feeling like all the muscles and the connective tissues? So go ahead, just put the tip of your finger in here. This might be what it feels like to feel skinless. Just a tip. You don't want to pull any out. There you go. Okay, go ahead and scrape it off. We'll give you a paper towel later. Thank you. Yeah. Just touch it lightly. That's what it might feel like, that if you didn't have any skin. So at this institute, we deal with skin, but we also deal with joints. And there's a particular illness that I want to tell you about called Lyme disease, L-Y-M-E. It is transmitted to you by an insect, and the insect looks like this. Anybody tell me what that is? It's not a spider. It starts with a T. Tick. It's a tick. But if it bites you, this is one of those insects that sucks your blood. It can get a bacteria into your blood and make you sick. And it makes your joints hurt and it makes you just feel generally terrible. So we don't want you to get that. So this is just a plastic version of the tick. This is what it actually looks like. It only has to be this big. Yeah, just that big in order to make you sick. So now see how easy it is to spot it on this white fabric, even as tiny as it is? It's a lot harder to spot it here, isn't it? On that darker fabric.
It's harder to see, right? Yeah.
Can you even find it?
It's harder to see.
Yeah, it took a while, didn't it? So if you go out like camping or into the woods, maybe you're going on a hike, or maybe you're rolling around in the grass, you know, having fun playing. The best thing to do is make sure that you can see that tick coming. So what might you wear?
What do you wear when you go camping?
What color clothes?
White, right?
Light colored clothes. You may have to wear like dark colored clothes, like if you're going on the woods, if you have like some jeans or something. But if you like tuck them into your socks, like into your white socks, you want to make sure you see that tick so that he doesn't bite you. That's the best thing to do is just prevent Lyme disease by making sure that tick doesn't bite you. And if you see them coming, you can get them off of you.
And this is what it looks like when you get bitten by one of the ticks. It's the kind of rash that appears on
your skin. Yeah, so if you ever see one of those, tell Mommy and Daddy right away so you can get some treatment for your Lyme. Okay, does anybody know what a whale is? Yeah. How about a walrus? How about a seal? Yeah? What do they have in common? They're all mammals, that's right. Where do they live? Yes, in the water, sometimes in the very, very cold water of the ocean. So, you remember we were talking earlier about how people have fat under their skin? Well, whales and walruses and seals, they have a lot of fat in order because they need that fat to keep them warm. And that's called blubber. So we're going to do like a little experiment. Caroline's going to give you each a glove. And then go ahead and put on the glove. Oops. And your hand doesn't have to go all in. And then she's going to cover it with some fat. She's going to cover it with some shortening. And then you're going to go ahead and stick your hand into that. There you go. That's good enough. That's good. Okay. So she's going to cover your gloved hand with some shortening. And then we want you to stick your both hands at the same time into that bowl of ice on the end there, that red bowl of ice. And we want you to tell us which hand gets cold first. Is it the one covered in fat, or is it the naked one? Okay, ready? Caroline's all ready for you.
Come down this way. Put both hands in at the same time and tell me which one is the coldest. Which one feels coldest?
That one. Yeah, the naked one feels colder.
This one is covered in blubber and it keeps the heat on the inside. This is what happens with the polar bears in the water. Thank you. There you go. Both hands. Which one feels colder? That one, right?
Okay, that's our last activity. Yeah, the naked one's always colder first. Well, thank you for joining us today at the Skin Zone.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. If you wait here, you're going to go on to the Muscle Zone in a minute. That was our last activity. I'm having a little trouble getting that off. Sorry.
Hi, welcome to the NIAMS bone area. We're going to be talking to kids and teaching them a little bit about bones with help from our friend, Mr. Bones Jr. So welcome to the bone area. So the first question we have for you is, what are two important reasons why we have bones? Any guesses? Okay, what's your guess? So we can move. That's very good. So one thing that bones give us is structure. So the backbone allows us to stand up, and we have bones in our arms so that our arms just don't go all flappy all over the place. So what's that? Like spaghetti, right. So what do you think is the, do you have a guess for the second reason why bones are important? Yeah, that's similar to helping us stand up. So can anyone touch their brain? No, why can't we touch our brains? Because you have the skull, that's right. So the skull, okay, that's Mr. Bones Jr., we'll be careful with him. The skull is very important to protect the brain, and the rib cage, which has 12 ribs, actually protects things like our heart and our lungs. So Mr. Bones Jr. here has 206 bones, and that's the number of bones in the human body. And the skull has 22 bones, and the face actually has 14 bones, and the backbone has 31 bones. So next question we have for you is, do you guys think bones are alive or are bones dead? They're alive. They're alive? So what do you think, alive or dead?
Alive.
What do you think? What's that?
Alive.
Okay, that's right. So you guys are all correct. Bones are alive. They're made up of a lot of cells and material, hard material. And because when you break a bone, your bone can heal itself if it's set in the right position. And one of the things that helps make your bones stronger is calcium. So calcium is a very important thing for everyone to eat, especially for growing kids like yourself. So we have a little quiz, and we're going to ask you some questions about which one has the most calcium or helps you with calcium. So we've got a bagel and ice cream. What do you guys think? All right, so we got to vote for ice cream. What do you think? Not sure. Okay. Okay. That's right. So it's ice cream. So ice cream comes from milk, and milk is an excellent source of calcium. So the next one is a little bit tricky. So we have tuna fish, and we have cheddar cheese flavored goldfish. What do you guys think has more calcium? Okay, so we got some votes for cheddar cheese goldfish crackers. Any votes for tuna fish? Yeah, this is tricky.
Tuna fish? I think tuna fish has protein.
Okay, well, even though goldfish crackers may have a little bit of cheddar cheese in them, it's not enough to give you a lot of calcium. So basically the right answer is tuna as a source of calcium. So, yeah, and protein. All right, so we got cheese, and we got chocolate chip cookies with milk chocolate chips. So which one do you think?
Cheese.
What do you think?
Cheese.
Okay, you guys are right. Milk chocolate doesn't have that much milk in it. So cheese comes from milk, so that's the big one. Yeah, chocolate is candy. So the next one is milk or lemonade? What do you guys think?
Milk.
No one's going to guess delicious lemonade? All right, you guys are right. It's milk. And then we have yogurt and salad dressing. Yogurt. You guys didn't even have to think about that. All right, that's right. Yogurt being dairy-based. And then we have oranges and broccoli. This one's tricky. Okay, so you're right. So broccoli has vitamin D, which is important for absorbing calcium.
Broccoli looks like a tree.
Broccoli does look a little bit like a tree. You're right. Okay, so those are... Yeah, so thanks for stopping by to our event. We have a few other activities, but we're going to say goodbye for now. Thank you. Okay, so we have a little quiz for you guys.